also hope that you received your timetable. Did you guys receive the timetable for essay 3? Yes or no? Yes, okay. So don't panic, don't panic. In your essay 3 grammar portions, I've added prepositions and subject verb agreement, okay? That is the two extra things that I've added. But apart from that, we have done everything, okay? So what I'm trying to tell is we will try and finish first a revision for prose. Remember, in third midterm, I have not given you any question and answers. So we've got a lot of question answers to be covered up, okay? So I've put it also in your classroom, and two more today. I'll put two more, one poem and one lesson again, okay? So what I'll try to do is we will first revise the question and answers, okay? Because grammar we have revised thoroughly for the midterm. It's the same portions, only the prepositions and subject verb agreement. That too, if we have time, listen carefully. If we have time, we will cover up that preposition and subject verb agreement, okay? If we do not have time, conjunctions is there. Conjunctions is there because we finished that before before midterm. I just didn't give it to you in the exam, but we finished that conjunctions. Okay. So what I'm telling to you, listen carefully. Preposition and subject verb agreement. Only if we have time after our revision, we will have that. If we have no time left, we will not cover that. It is just there in your portions. Leave it as it is, but you will not, we will not do that. Agreed? Are you listening carefully? Are you listening carefully? Because we have to wind up with, we have to start revising our prose because we haven't done prose at all for so many weeks because we were concentrating only on grammar. And now that we've almost finished everything, it's just that devastation, that catastrophe, and another in time of drought. I doubt if I want to give this. I don't think I'll give you that poem in time of drought. Okay, so till what is that lesson? Courage in the face of catastrophe. Only till here. From where? From behind the scenes. We have finished only Walt Disney, okay, for the second essay 2. So for midterm we didn't have prose. So from behind the scenes till in time of catastrophe, okay, courage at the time of, only till here we will have. So we will first finish with the revision of the prose. If we have time to pick on grammar to start new grammar chapter, then only we will touch preposition and this one. Sorry, what am I talking? Yeah, sorry, not so we for you in legends in sports, I think, right? No, Little Eyes Upon You. Yes. Little Eyes Upon You is what we have to start from. Little Eyes Upon You till courage during in the time of catastrophe. Okay, only if you have time after revising everything, then we will start with preposition. If you do not have time, just don't worry. In your portion, just cancel that preposition. If at all you've taken a copy, just put an into near preposition and subject verb agreement, and also in time of drought. Okay, in time of drought, that poem, please ignore it for now. What all we have done, we will try to become perfect in that only. All right. So without a further ado, did you get that crossword on page number 116? And I asked you to do that independent clauses. Did you guys do it or no? All right. So wait, we will discuss this later on. Now we will I will share the screen to you. I want to show you that this one. One second. Which is that? Yeah, Little Eyes Upon You. Okay, so we are starting our revision with Little Eyes Upon You. Pay attention, pay attention, pay attention. Okay, so I'm going to take you through and then we'll see how much we can revise today. Please pay attention. We have less time, no time for revision, so I'm trying to rush a bit. All right. Okay. So in this poem, we do not have meanings because it is quite a very simple poem. We do not have complicated words where we can fetch in meanings for this. So just I've just put synonyms. Okay. So what is a synonym of devoutly? Devoutly means earnestly. Okay. Devoutly is earnestly. Devoutly is earnestly. Suspicion. suspicions, suspicion. If anybody is having suspicions about him or her or they, them, it means that there's somebody is doubting that person. Okay, I have a suspicion that she stole my pouch or whatever. Okay, so suspicion means doubt. Idol is a person who is greatly admired and loved. Okay, simple, simple. Devotedly, earnestly. As I am revising, if you concentrate and keep it in your mind, I think this will do. Okay, so devotedly, it means earnestly. Suspicions, doubt. Idol is a person who is greatly admired and loved. Okay, devotedly, earnestly. Suspicions, doubt. Idol, a person who is greatly admired and loved. All right, moving on. Now, I've just given you the first two stanzas as your memory lines, which is pretty easy. Okay, so repeat after me. There are little eyes upon you, and they're watching night and day. There are little ears that quickly take in every word you say. Simple, okay? There are little eyes upon you, and they're watching night and day. There are little ears that quickly take in every word you say. There are little hands all eager to do anything you do. And a little boy who's dreaming of a day he'll be like you. That's it. Okay. This is written by Avleek Dheeman. Okay, Avleek Dheeman. Okay. So repeat it after me. There are little eyes upon you, and they're watching night and day. There are little ears that quickly take in every word you say. There are little hands all eager to do anything you do. And a little boy who's dreaming of a day he'll be like you. Okay, Avleek Dheeman, okay? Then next one. What does the poet mean by the words, there are little eyes upon you? So the poet means to say that there's a young child carefully observing and watching all the actions and words of his idol. Okay, that is what it means. There are little eyes upon you. Okay, the poet means to say that there's a young child who's carefully observing and watching all the actions and words of his idol. Okay, carefully observing and watching all the words of his idol. Who is that? A little child who's carefully observing and watching all the actions and words of his idol. Okay, now the poet wants all athletes to be careful of what they say and do. Okay, why does he want them to be cautious of their speech and action? So the poet wants all athletes to be careful. Take that same sentence in from the question into the answer. Okay, careful of what they say and do, because the young child who is watching them will copy all that they say and do. Simple. Okay, because the young child who is watching will copy all that they say and do. Okay. The poet wants all athletes to be careful of what they say and do, because the young child is watching them and will copy all that they say and do. Simple. How does the little fellow consider his idol? The little fellow considers his idol to be the wisest among all the wise people. Okay. If someone is an idol to someone, okay, we think they are the most prettiest. We think they are the most most beautiful. We think they are the wisest of all. Okay. And there's no one like them. So similarly, this little fellow considers his idol to be the wisest among all the wise people. All right. Now, why does the little fellow have complete faith in his idol? Because he thinks that his idol can do no wrong, and he believes in him wholeheartedly. Okay. See, if somebody is an idol to someone, we think that person is perfect. Nothing could go wrong. Okay. And whatever that person does is just absolutely 100% sure. So just like that, he because he thinks that his idol can do no wrong, and he behaves in him and believes in him wholeheartedly. Okay, he believes in him wholeheartedly. All right. Hold that all you say and do, he will say and do in your way. What does the poet mean by hold? Okay, the poet means to say not only that by hold, not only that. Hold on means just wait, there's something more coming up. So the poet means not only that, not only that. It means by hold. Okay, and what will he say and do exactly? What you say and do? Who is he here? He will say and do exactly what you say and do. That is a line from the poem. Take it just like that. Because he idolizes you and wants to grow up to be just like you in every way. Okay. The he here is the little boy who's watching his idol carefully. All right. Okay. Why will he say and do exactly what you say and do? Who is he? Why will he say and do? Because he is idolizing you and wants to grow up to be just like you in every way. That's why he say and do exactly what you say and do. Okay. So the he is referred to that little boy who's watching his idol carefully. Okay. What responsibility rests on the people to whom the poem is addressed? The people who are addressed have to be careful of their actions and words, because the little boy is following all that they do and say to be like them. Simple. Okay. The poem, the people are addressed, the people who are addressed have to be careful of their actions, their words, because there are little boys who are watching them. They want to follow them and they want to be and they want to do and say like them. So the people who all are addressed, the poet is telling you all have to watch your actions and your words, because there are so many people who want to do and want to say just like you. Okay, so that's about this one. Next one, you are setting an example every day in all you do. What is the meaning of setting an example? Setting an example means to say and do something in an exemplary manner so that it can be followed by others. In an exemplary manner means in an extraordinary manner, in a manner that cannot be compared to anybody else. Okay, so this is how we set an example. Okay, we set an example means to say and do something in an exceptional, in an extraordinary, or in an exemplary manner so that it can be followed by others. Okay, it can be followed. I do not know how many of you have examples. I mean, how many of you have your role models in your life? Okay, so if you look at your role models, they set a kind of standard for you to follow. So that is called an exemplary manner, something in an exemplary manner, so it can be followed by others. Okay, setting an example means to say and do something in an exemplary manner so that it can be followed by others. All right. So how is the little boy described in the poem? The little boy is described as a keen observer whose eyes are always watching, his ears are alert, his hands are eager to do what his idol does. He is watching for the day, he is waiting for the day when he can grow up to be like his idol. Okay, the entire all these answers revolve around one particular idea, that is an idol, what he says and what he does. In all the answers, you almost have that, what he says, what he does, what he says, what he does. Okay, so it's easy to learn. That's what I'm trying to say. Okay, how is this little boy? He is described as an observer whose eyes are always watching. Okay, his eyes are always watching, his ears are alert. His hands are eager to do what his idol does. Okay, he's just waiting for the day when he can grow up to become like him, like his idol. He's just waiting for that day. Okay, I don't know. I mean, in movies and all, or even in your real life, you must have heard your small brothers or you yourself saying, I want to become like daddy, or I want to grow up. I'm just waiting to grow up, become like my brother. Okay, cool and nice and all that. Okay, so just like that, this he is described as a person whose eyes are always watching, whose ears are alert, whose hands wants to do what his idol does, and also waiting for the day when he can grow up to be an just like his idol. Okay, why do you think the little boy would wish to grow up to be like you? Because he earnestly believes that his idol is the wisest of the wise and always right. The same answers are being repeated again and again, so it's not difficult for you to learn it. Okay, So the little boy would wish to grow up to be like you because he earnestly believes that his idol is the wisest of the wise and is always right. Okay, simple answers. Okay, so this is about this lesson. I mean, this poem, The Little Eyes Upon You, very simple. What's the meaning of devoutly? Earnestly, suspicions, doubt, idol, a person who's greatly admired and loved. Okay, a person who's greatly admired and loved. Okay, now the memory lines, there are little eyes upon you and they're watching night and day. And there are little ears that quickly take in every word you say. There are little hands all eager to do anything you do. And a little boy who's dreaming of a day he'll be like you. Okay, Avleek Dhiman. What does the poet mean by the words, there are little eyes upon you? It means that there's a young child who's carefully observing and watching all the actions and words of his idol. Okay, now same answer in the next one. Why does he want them to be cautious of their speech and action? Because the poet wants all at least to be careful of what they say and do, because young child is watching them and copying all that they do and say. How does a little fellow consider his idol? He considers his idol as the wisest among all the wise people. Okay, why does the little fellow have complete faith in his idol? Because he thinks his idol can do no wrong and he believes in him wholeheartedly. Okay, what does the poet mean by saying hold? It means not only that. Okay, it simply means not only that, but also so. Okay, and why will he say and do exactly what you say and do? Why? Because he idolizes you and wants to grow up to be like you in every single way. Okay, so that he is referred to this little boy who's watching his idol carefully. Okay, take the first sentence of the question into the answer. Okay, what responsibility rests on the people? The responsibility is that we have to be careful of the actions and the words that we use, because there are little boys or girls, whoever, who's following all that they say and do to be like them. Okay, so we have to watch. That's why parents will never fight in front of children. Parents will never use mean words to one another in front of children. Parents will never abuse one another in front of children. Okay, at least as far as I know. I do not know in your homes, but yeah, it's like this, because children model parents. So it's always wise for parents to have discussions, if at all they have any arguments, away from children. Probably send them out to play or give them something to eat or switch on the TV, and then you can settle your small arguments and then they can come back. Okay, that's why parents never encourage fighting. Even they do not encourage siblings fighting also, because you could have a smaller one who's watching the older one fighting in front of them. Okay, so this is called as modeling. We make models, we make idols to ourselves. All right. Yeah, so people have to be careful of whatever they say and do. What is the meaning of setting an example? It means to say and do something in an exemplary manner so that you're followed by others. Okay, so that can be followed by others. How is the little boy described? He's described as a keen observer whose eyes are always watching, his ears are alert, his hands are eager to do what his idol does. He's waiting for the day when he can grow up to be just like his idol. Okay, why do you think the little boy would wish to grow up to be like you? Because he thinks you're the wisest of all and always right. Okay, because he believes that his idol is the wisest and also always right. Okay, that's it. Simple, pretty simple, right? One second. Okay. Next one is luncheon. Okay, luncheon. Yes. Let's look into the meaning of meanings. All right. Beckoning. What do we mean by beckoning? I beckoned you means attracting someone's attention by a hand gesture. Like for example, you're at a party and you're figuring out where your friend is. What would you do? Hey, you raise your hands up like this, right? That is called a beckon. I beckoned her. She did not see me. That's not my problem. All right. So beckoning is attracting someone's attention by a hand gesture. By a hand gesture. It's not gesture. It's gesture. Okay. Attracting someone's attention by a hand gesture. Gesture. Not gay. Not girl for gun. Jur for jug. Gesture. All right. Next one. Senators. Who are senators? They're none other than ministers. Senators are important people. They're ministers. Okay. Anticipated. What do we mean by anticipated? Expected. Okay. Anticipated means expected. I expected. Like, I'm waiting in anticipation for the principal's reply to my request for leave. So what am I saying? I'm expecting the principal's reply for my request for leave. Okay, on my request for leave. That's meaning of anticipation, which means expectation. Anticipated, expected. Okay. Salmon. Remember, it's not salmon over there. L is silent. You have that behind your book also. Some silent words I told you to find out and write it down. Okay. So salmon is a large sea fish. Most of the Westerners, they eat salmon. And it's very tasty. Of course, in India also, we eat salmon. It's a very tasty fish, but it's extremely costly. Just like vanjaram. Salmon. Salmon is just like vanjaram. Okay, it's extremely costly. It's a large sea fish. It's just got one thin bone in the center. That's it. Okay, so it's very fleshy and nice to eat. Salmon is a large fish. Not salmon. Salmon. Okay, salmon. Salmon. L is silent there. Caviar. What is caviar? Caviar is the pickled eggs of a large fish. Fish's eggs, they're taken out and they are made into pickle. Pickle, okay, pickles. So that is called as caviar. The pickled eggs of a large fish. Pickled eggs of a large fish, okay. Effusive, what do you mean by effusive? Expressing gratitude enthusiastically. Wow, like for example, If you have won the championship award in sports, okay, obviously when the chief guest gives you a shake hand, we don't do it very lame. Thank you, sir. Not softly. Thank you, sir. We are very excited. We are very happy that we won the biggest trophy for sports, the championship award, which nobody else could win. You have won it. So expressing gratitude enthusiastically is called as effusive. In an effusive manner, I took a handshake from the chief guest, for example. Okay. Amicable. What do you mean by amicable? She's friendly. A person who's friendly. If you're describing a person, I would say, well, my best friend, she lives in Bangalore, and she's an amicable person. Means she's a friendly person. She's not boring. Okay. She's a friendly person. Amicable. If you're introducing someone. Okay. Amicable person. Fine. Asparagus. What is asparagus? A vegetable. It's a spring vegetable. Okay. It's a spring vegetable. So vegetable that grows in spring. Spring vegetable. Okay. Palate. What is palate? Palate actually means the upper part of your mouth. Inside your mouth, the upper jaw, where you put your finger in, up. It's called as palate. But over here, it's referred to as appetite. Okay. Over here in this lesson, it is referred to as appetite. For example, the fact is you ruin your palate by all the meat you eat. That's the sentence in the textbook. Means what? You're ruining your appetite by all the meat that you eat. You have to wait for something exciting that's coming up. Don't eat only meat and satisfy your hunger. That's what it means. Okay. Palate over here means appetite. TI is pronounced as ingratiating, that which is done for another's approval. Ingratiating is done for another person's approval. For example, like while we were waiting for the coffee, the head waiter with an ingratiating smile on his false face came up to us bearing a large basket full of huge peaches. Lord knew what they cost. That's the sentence taken from the textbook. Okay, so what is ingratiating? If at all anybody would like to taste a new dish, okay? And your friend is saying, try, man, try, try. If you are hesitating to try, come on, try, 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 try. They give you that smile that you cannot resist to take it and eat it. That is called as ingratiating, okay? That which is done for another's approval. Okay, ingratiating smile, okay? So, again, from the beginning, beckoning. What did I say, beckoning? Attracting someone's attention by a hand gesture. Gesture is not gesture, it's gesture. Gesture. Senators are ministers. Anticipated means expected. I anticipated this kind of a result. Okay, I expected this result. Anticipated. Salmon, it's not salmon, it's salmon, a large sea fish. Caviar, the pickled eggs of a large fish. Effusive, what do you mean by effusive? Expressing gratitude enthusiastically. Okay, Who is an amicable person? An amicable person is a very friendly person. Friendly, amicable, friendly. Asparagus, it's a spring vegetable. Vegetable that grows in the spring season. Spring vegetable. Palate over here refers to appetite. Palate is appetite. Ingratiating means that which is done for another person's approval. Ingratiating. All right. Moving on. Appetite means the opposite of appetite is hatred or dislike. I don't like this particular dish. Appetite means dislike or hatred. Okay, appetite means dislike or hatred. Effusive means restrained. What is the opposite of effusive? Restrained. Okay, the meaning of effusive is somebody is giving you, thanking you very enthusiastically. So opposite is when you are not wanting their thanks and you hold back. If it's a stranger, we don't say, hi, stranger, very happily, right? We restrain ourselves. Means we hold back our hi. Okay, so that is the meaning of opposite of effusive, restrained. Amicable, unfriendly. Amicable, opposite is unfriendly. Ingratiating. The opposite of ingratiating is disgusting. Okay. Disgusting. Appetite, dislike or hatred. Effusive, restrained. Amicable, unfriendly. Ingratiating, disgusting. Once again, appetite, dislike or hatred. Effusive is restrained. Amicable, unfriendly. Ingratiating, disgusting. Okay, fine. Let's move on to the questions. Answer in 20 words. How many years ago did the narrator and the guest meet for the first time? So they met 20 years ago. So this lesson, if you have read this lesson, I asked you to read this lesson. Okay. If you have read this lesson clearly, this is actually a flashback of the 20 years ago, what had happened. Okay. Now after 20 years, they are meeting over here. They are meeting over here after 20 years. So in that, this guy will remember, oh gosh, this lady was the one who actually ruined my luncheon. She made me pay extra. Okay, so this is a flashback of what happened 20 years back. All right, so the narrator and his guest met for the first time 20 years ago. At which restaurant? They had lunch at Fayots. Okay, then name the restaurant where they had lunch. They had lunch at Fayots. Why did the narrator think that the restaurant was far beyond his means? Because it was where the French senators ate. Okay, far beyond his means means he was not able to afford eating in at this place, at this restaurant for yours. Why? Because all ministers would come there and eat. Probably the food would be much more expensive than at the other restaurant. So he thought it was far beyond his means because it was where the French senators ate. So he thought he would not afford eating over here at this Fayot restaurant. What dishes did the woman eat for luncheon? Oh, so many. She have salmon, caviar, asparagus, a huge peach, ice cream, and a coffee, and also champagne. Champagne. It's not champagne. It's champagne. Okay. Please keep listen to the way I'm pronouncing these words, because these are very common words that you come across in whenever you listen to any English movies, whenever you watch news, or whenever you read books. Okay, so these are, you will have to be able to pronounce it. Wherever you see CH, it is CH sometimes. It is also SH sometimes. Okay, salmon, caviar, asparagus, a huge peach. Peach is a fruit. Huge peach, ice cream, coffee, champagne for luncheon. She had so many things. Okay, so what dishes did the woman eat for luncheon? She had salmon, caviar, asparagus, ice cream, large peach, coffee, and champagne for luncheon. All right. Why does the narrator decide to go for lunch with the woman? Because he was flattered that she had read a book of his and wanted to talk to her about it. Okay. Why did the narrator decide to go for lunch with the woman? Because he was flattered that she had read the book of his and wanted to talk to him about it. Or wanted to talk to her. Sorry, it is her, not him. Okay, wanted to talk to her about it. That's why the narrator decided to go for lunch with this woman. Okay, why? Because she thought that he read her book. She read his book and he was flattered. So he actually wanted to talk about what impressed. What was your impression about the book? Which part of the book did you like? He wanted to talk something about the book, but landed up, paying extra for all that she ate. Fine. The woman kept repeating phrase, "I never eat more than one thing." Why is this funny? Why is this funny? You should tell me, why is it funny? Because she just said that she would not eat more than this, but she ended up ordering more than what she wanted to eat. Okay, so the answer is, it is funny because though the woman kept saying that she did not have more than one thing for luncheon, she gorged herself on almost all expensive things the restaurant had to offer. Okay, because she gorged herself on all the most expensive things the restaurant had to offer. Okay, simple answer. It is funny because though the woman kept saying that she did not have more than one thing for luncheon, she gorged herself on all the expensive things that the restaurant had to offer. That's why it's funny. Okay. Who says that I never eat more than one thing and end up eating more than 8 items? We don't do that. Okay. Fine. Does the narrator enjoy his meals? Give reasons for your answer. No, the narrator does not enjoy his luncheon because he was shattered at the expensive things the woman had, because he had very little money and he never knew that it would cost, this restaurant would be so expensive. First of all, he hesitated there because he knew only French senators would come and sit over there. And now that he was shattered because this lady, she started ordering so many expensive stuff. So he was anxious and he wondered if the money he had would be sufficient to pay the bill. He thought he would have to leave his watch and come back and pay later. Okay, so finally, this guy, he did not enjoy having luncheon because he was shattered at the expensive things the woman had. And he was also anxious and wondered if he had sufficient money to pay the bill. And he also thought that he would leave his watch and come back and pay later. Okay, simple answer. At one point in the story, a happy smile spreads over the waiter's face. Why? Why? Because they had asparagus, which was so large, splendid, and tender that it was almost incredible. Okay, why did, at this one point of the story, why did this happy smile spread over the waiter's face? Because they had just gotten fresh and good large asparagus that had just come into the restaurant. So he wanted them to have it. That's why he gave that broad smile. Okay, they were so large, splendid, and tender, and it was almost incredible. Okay, asparagus, if you wonder what's the taste of asparagus, is nothing, just like beans. We have beans, right? Beans, just like beans, this asparagus. But they eat beans less, they eat asparagus more. All right. Do you remember the first time I saw you? Who said this and to whom? Okay, the woman said this to the narrator. What happened when the listener heard this? When the listener heard this, he remembered instantly what had happened when he had taken her for luncheon. Okay, so, one second. Yeah, what I want to do now is, oops. Okay, so we almost cross the time limit. All right, so please learn that poem. Which one? Little Eyes Upon You and the Luncheon Antonym Synonyms. That's enough. Antonym Synonyms only. Little Eyes Upon You, everything. All right, and we'll see you in the next class. Thank you. Bye.